of social institutions and that the morphologies speak and guide the structures, but that we need more. We need more than just, we do it to ourselves as well, the fashion system. That's not fanciful, that's semiology at work. But also we need to, the morphology which the technical capacities deliver and the variety of technical reasons is not enough. It brings some kind of repertoire. We need to increase versatility and we add that graphic layer. So that's one way to do it. And there is not a single culture which hasn't been doing this. The necessity of semiology becomes clear. But there's a degree of arbitrariness if you just apply color coding or some random graphics. Usually they never told you when they have an origin. But you can see here a similar to the system of distinction, differentiation, what counts as the system of differences. So you can realize the same chess game like this, or in various particle ways. So these would be your artistic choice. So here there's not many technical demands on this, but it opens up what counts as a system of differences, a network of what I've also called similitudes of contrast. So arbitrary versus tectonic articulation. So we need articulation. We could do it in an arbitrary way like the chessboard. But I say, hey, why not, and this has always been in the history of architecture done, use and double functionalize what's already coming with respect to the functional and technical morphologies and reduce that. Because different institutions with different spans, different fenestration formations, etc., different thermal conditions will bring something into the game, and then, but you need to heighten, you need to orchestrate, you need to make that the sociological project using these tectonic materials. And these kind of ordering of it on the surface, maybe with hard surface carpet, etc., is an important orienting and ordering sphere. So I just want to show you one project where we work on this and using tectonic systems to articulate the university with multiple faculties and subsidiary, multiple schools, each with subsidiary faculties with various types of institutions, whether it's lecture halls, libraries, seminar rooms, workshops, which are different social activities and configurations, and that we start to use, let's say, repertoire shells. We're not saying use the optimal shell, if that exists, and then make everything only one criteria, namely technical optimality, but use a faceted, increase the smooth shell to distinguish various schools, use these floor room patterns to have different types of activity institutions across different schools. And then you can make that combinatorics, that drama starts taking place. And I'm just walking you through how one would build up a semiological project, a system of simplification, but not using arbitrary colors and shapes to invent, but using engineered forms. That's kind of tectonism, and you can articulate now ways of combining shells to intermediate, diffusion, to intersection. And that means something how you how the relationships between various spaces articulate trees versus schools, so the two schools meet, for instance. And this becomes about making legible very specific institutional relationships arrangements. Nesting logics and so on. Of course you work on the technical optimality, semi-optimality is always taken for granted, always runs along. It's always embedded and pre-constrained. But now you're working on composing them in ways which make legible and distinct and articulate relationships. Of course, articulation, again, you have multiple choices, and again, these choices correlate with meanings within the institutions, things which deserve to be distinguished, this degree of distinction. distinctness or closeness, proximity or distance in terms of belonging. So there's again multiple choices, and which one you choose depends on how it fits into an overall network, an overall orchestrated composition, let's say. Whether you then say these are too similar or too contrasting, because you look at an overall network. And again, structural logic is always at play and can be critiqued and optimized, and then see if that still can be brought under the orchestrated simulation project, which is the driver for us. That's what our responsibility is. And we are willing to give up certain margins of efficiency to make this possible. But we can do this, we can use all the optimization tools to build up a repertoire. And this is the way this kind of builds up and layers up and comes together in a kind of complex university project. Of course, the idea here is that everything means something. There's very particular messages and nested relationships, and the grammar and plays a complex text which orders our process of navigation. It's something you can't appreciate in a single glance. You have to imagine that you brought up to understand these and intuit these distinctions, like you intuit your own language. You don't have to think about it anymore. What a certain tone implies. And also to put that in perspective, finally, the projects we are now having in the office, a big kind of bureau launcher or technology branch of a big bank, and the way we build up projects, distinctions, types of activities, furnishings, and here is not always the comfort of seating, only the arrangement of the figures, but the semiology at play, the principles, different types of activities have different morphologies, features, and again, that will be a project worth pursuing. I'm just showing a few sketches of something which is going on right now in the other, and trying to do this. You can see the different morphologies distinguishing leisure and circulation space from business space, unbound versus bound, and two types of business spaces, workspace, meeting spaces, convex versus concave, and each of them, of course, with a character variety. These are not stereotypical, these are not traffic signs. Each comes with a whole variety, and then you have types of boundary. Bookable versus allocated, public, simple, and private, all these things mean something. And you can, once you settle this thing, you can also look at, hey, is there kind of a gradient transformation one to the other? That's parametric semiology, which is parametricism's take, which is more sophisticated than the postmodernist take could have ever been. And in-between functions become then possible. You then have a building a grammar how these interact, and you have to test whether the convex, the workspace, the meeting room, where they work together, whether two workspaces could come together. If you indicate overlap between two workspaces, can you generate an overlap where the workspace is an overlap of two workspaces? That can become a meeting space? Yes, it can, so you test out the vocabulary in some kind of grammatical system, so that it's delivering the meaning potentials you want to embed. Then you develop a kind of a matrix of kind of grammar textbook of the language. This is building up a language. And at the moment, this is not yet tectonism, but these are function-driven morphologies. Furnishings fit in and become congenial. So the meeting table is also a convex table, and the work table is a concave table, and that makes sense also with working and meeting. So we need to also feed back the semiology with functionality. So but since we have so much form variety that we actually can find in that triple search or double search, the coincident forms which meet multiple criteria, functional, semiological, tectonic criteria. And you can see that we generated them spaces. This, by the way, all Chinese team, and we count PLL generation, and they're halfway through the project. And now I'm saying this, these worlds become quite homogenous quite quickly. So what we need to do is maybe move from this to these forms of articulation and vary them. And then see also how what you see here is important, a tectonic articulation orchestrated with a system, within a system of signification. We're designing a network of contrasts and similitudes, because you could say that these two are similar in one dimension, so they belong together. Of course, across these two are similar to carbon fiber and materiality, these two morphology and form, and again you have this similarity. You have multiple contrasts and similarities in a complex network, and I think that's very important, that's very sophisticated, and this you now imprint back onto that, and you have tectonism delivering the Sengoshiro project, a new level of sophistication. So we have tectonism, but we don't have its true architectural implementation. At the moment, we are in the proto-engineering stage of tectonism. And then the last thing is that we want to, I can't play the videos, that we're actually using agent-based simulations to operationalize and illustrate and embed the meanings of all these distinctions of types of activity, types of interaction, demeanor, engagement, separation, and so on, in this kind of agent-based system. So my research program is called Agent-Based Programmatic Semiology. That's maybe that's in the last image, but you need to imagine that this they're roaming and moving and oriented and guided in the kind of tectonism articulated built environment. But this is a little bit but I wanted to show it because Philip yesterday started with showing we also have these spaces sensors and we measure what's going on, but we try to construct rule sets calibrated with the intercalator to simulate and then vary the scene and predict which one is the most optimal. This is now social functionality optimization configuration and articulation of such a space. Okay, so my summary statement, architectural tectonic form is multifunction and needs to be selected according to two sets of very different functional selection criteria, technical functionality in terms of physical performance and social functionality in terms of communicative performance. The coincidences between these two criteria are serendipitous. So these are chances, we are chancing for these synergies. But since we have so many things to go through, I think we are chancing with high probability of success, and with this statement,